Hello and welcome to this part of the unit where we will discuss about the solid hydrogen storage technology and we will make a comparison between the different types of hydrogen storage. This name of solid hydrogen storage is used for a storage system in which aqueous hydrogen becomes part of the molecular composition of a solid compound, either by reaction and adsorption, as in the case of metal hydrides, or only by adsorption as in organic compounds. Metal hydrides are intermetallic compounds that trap hydrogen at moderate pressures. This type of storage system are based on the principle that certain metals under condition of high pressure and moderate temperature absorb hydrogen gas forming metal hydrides. When these metal hydrides are heated at low pressure, the hydrogen is released. Therefore, they have considerable potential for storing hydrogen cyclically. Assuming that the heat needed for desorption comes from residual heat, for example from the fuel cell itself, it is estimated that the energy consumed by this type of storage is of the order of 13% of the lower heating value of hydrogen, being comparable to a storage in compressed hydrogen at 700 bars. Among its advantages, when compared to liquid hydrogen and compressed hydrogen, we can affirm that it is a safety system as it does not require high pressures. Hydrogen becomes part of the chemical structure of the metal itself and therefore metal hydrides do not require high pressure or cryogenic temperatures to function. Since hydrogen is released from the hydride at low pressure, this type of storage is intrinsically the safest of all. On the other hand, it guarantees a stable storage and it has a volumetric storage capacity which allows more compactness. However, there are also some disadvantages, such as its high cost, its weight, and the need of high purity hydrogen. Metal hydrides must be charged with high purity hydrogen or they will be contaminated with the corresponding loss of capacity which can be reactivated to a certain extent with heat. Another problem associated with metal hydrides concerns is their structure. Metal hydrides are usually produced in the form of grains or dust to increase the surface area available for gas storage. This particulate material is very sensitive to wear, which reduces its performance. In order to obtain suitable alloys, the properties of hydrides can be controlled by changing their composition and microscopic structure. There are many classes of metal hydrides, although all are based on metal alloys of magnesium, nickel, iron, or titanium. In general, metal hydrides are divided between high and low desorption temperature hydrides. High temperature hydrides are less expensive and store more hydrogen than low temperature hydrides. However, they require large amount of heat in order to release hydrogen. On the other hand, in low temperature hydrides, the low temperature can be a problem because the gas is released too easily in environmental conditions. In order to solve this problem, low temperature hydrides must be pressurized, which increases the complexity of the process. In the table, we can see a classification of different hydrides depending on their composition. The first one are metal hydrides based on magnesium, which are among the most studied due to their large storage capacity of hydrogen by weight and low cost. Absorption and emission temperature range goes from 15 to 550 degrees Celsius. Their main problems are in the absorption and emission times and in the number of cycles that remain stable. In the second column, we find the metal hydride based on magnesium nickel, which has been widely studied for its relatively high storage capacity in weight that varies from 2.5 to 5%, its low cost, its low weight, and its low toxicity. In this case, their absorption and emission temperature range goes from 200 to 350 degrees Celsius. Within the group of complex hydrates are those based on sodium aluminate and lithium. The main characteristic of hydrates based on sodium aluminate are that they have an absorption and emission temperature range between 25 and 260 degrees Celsius. And the number of cycles that they remain stable are 32. On the other hand, for lithium-based hydrates, the adsorption and emission temperature range is between 25 and 450 degrees Celsius, and the number of cycles they remain stable are 14. The last type is the metal hydride based in intermetallic compounds, whose research began more than 40 years ago. The discovery of the absorption of hydrogen by lanthanum nickel alloy, an iron compound with titanium, opened up new possibilities for its industrial development. Prototypes with high weight and low absorption capacity are now available. Their main characteristics are a range of absorption and emission temperature of between -196 and 327 degrees Celsius, and the number of cycles they remain stable are 1000 cycles. An important aspect to highlight is that with continued use, the alloys disintegrate, giving rise to a toxic dust. Current research focuses on improving the characteristic of both alloys, for example, increasing their capacity, durability or reactivity, and the containers, for example, decreasing their weight and volume or increasing their durability. The second option for solid storage is the storage by carbon materials. Conveniently treated active carbon can be used to store hydrogen, with a density of about 50 grams per liter of hydrogen at 77 degrees Kelvin and 3.5 megapascal. The storage by adsorption in active carbon has the same advantages as compression storage. For a given equivalent density value of stored gas, adsorption requires a lower pressure, and at the same time equivalent pressure, more gas is stored through adsorption. Therefore, it has a great economic advantage as it reduces the cost of compression. However, for better storage, it may be necessary to lower the temperature, involving an initial investment in cryogenic deposit. There are two options for storage by adsorption. The first one is to use carbon nanotubes, which are small tubes that have a large area per unit area, a small macroporosity, an uniform microporosity, a high thermal conductivity, and an adsorption capacity of 10% by weight. Current research is focused on how to produce nanotubes at competitive prices. Nanotubes are interesting materials because of their nanometric size, which has extremely small pores, and the interior of the tube, which is a potential site for hydrogen adsorption. The interest in carbon nanotubes also lies in the fact that there are more sites where adsorption is possible. This happens because the nanotubes can bind to each other with the carbon material, providing additional adsorption sites to the internal cylinder formed by the nanotubes. The storage pressure is about 4 and 5 megapascal, and the filling time ranges from 4 to 24 hours. On the other hand, the other option consists in the use of carbon nanofibers, in which hydrogen molecules are adsorbed between the graphite layers that form the nanofibers. A great deal of research has also done on carbon nanofibers. In fact, comparative studies between various forms of carbon reveal that the maximum adsorption capacity was less than 0.1% by weight at 90 bars and at room temperature. Additionally, by using a nickel coating, storage of 2.2% by weight has obtained. When comparing the different available storage technologies, it is not enough to quantify the hydrogen storage capacity on the basis of the percentage by mass that it is capable of storing. The hydrogen store capacity data of a system represent the mass of stored hydrogen divided by the amount resulting from adding the mass of hydrogen, the material that stored it, and the storage container. Another interesting parameter, especially in mobile and portable applications, is the volumetric capacity. This is the mass of hydrogen stored per unit volume, with the same caution about the reference volume considered. In the graph, we can see the relationship between volumetric and gravimetric capacity for each of the different storage alternatives. In addition to the gravimetric and volumetric capacity of the storage system, it is necessary to take into account the tank filling time, the additional requirements during filling such as temperature and pressure control, the energy efficient both in loading and unloading hydrogen, the leakage losses, the volume needed in the vehicle, the availability to adapt to different shapes and spaces, the safety aspect, or the economic cost, among others. Gaseous of liquid hydrogen storage is a potential candidate for onboard storage. However, the losses due to the boil-off effect and requirement of high liquefaction energy are the principal detriments. Therefore, solid-state hydrogen storage is potentially superior when considering energy efficiency, safety, and gravimetric and volumetric storage capacities. Nevertheless, the only storage system that is currently commercially available for use in vehicles is compressed hydrogen. Here, the most expensive component in pressurized system are the reinforcing material used to work at high pressure. On the other hand, tanks for storing liquid hydrogen have a lower cost due to the lower working pressure. However, cooling system, insulation, compressor for gas losses, etc. make the overall system quite expensive. Metal hydrides are reasonably priced, but still present major durability problems and regeneration is costly. Furthermore, hydride complexes result in much higher system cost due to the special pressure and temperature control vessel that are required. Finally, the most advanced storage system, hydrides and porous carbon solids, are still at the laboratory stage. Therefore, a realistic cost estimate cannot be made yet. In the picture below, we can see a comparison inside of the different storage tanks when using each of the storage technology mentioned. As we can appreciate, the gaseous storage is quite large compared to the equivalent storage using hydrides. In summary, although by gravimetric and volumetric capacity values the liquefied hydrogen and some hydrides appear to be the most advantageous, several associated problems significantly decrease the efficiency of these technologies. In the short term, only compressed hydrogen seems to be the one that combines a series of factors that make it the most favorable technology for storing hydrogen in a vehicle. With this, we conclude the part of the different options to store hydrogen.